think so. A little bit longer. Okay. So let me see. Huh? This is my harmonium. Sorry. I and mine. Sorry, I'm on this platform of I and mine. And to be honest, I'm pretty protective over my harmonium. I don't, yes, sorry, because, you know, harmoniums are pretty sensitive. Or is Danuda Swami really fond of this harmonium and he really wants to play with it or something?
I really want, but just in case. I didn't know that this year was going to be different.
Because yesterday it disappeared and I was thinking, where's my harmonium? And now we know the thief, the harmonium thief. Bring it back. And is it today the last class there? Or next week also? Is Danuda Maharaj giving next week also class? No, next week.
Next week.
No, so it's the last time?
Yep.
Okay, last time you can have it. If it would be a regular thing, I might want to think about it. Now that's all right, it's the last time. I picked it up this morning, you know. This morning I came looking for my harmonium and I found it this morning. No, I mean, it's the last time. Let them have it, you know. It will be good purification for me to give the harmonium a service.
He was quiet over the office.
Sorry?
He was quiet like a flock.
Yes, yes, he was. I would have missed him. I think you were saying or something. You know, yeah, I would have not noticed it. So that's why he must have pitched it yesterday.
What else did
that? Okay. Let's get back into the topic. Before we touch upon a few other little things, are there any more questions about, you know, how to practically do things and the different programs and the etiquette, and is there anything else about that? Yes?
How can we select the people?
Sorry?
How can we select the people?
Like, how can we select the people? Hang on, I don't understand. You mean select which people? Select the counselors who can give shelter?
If you want to do the program.
See, the program, we start like this. I said there's two levels. One level is the possible caregivers. So a senior person who can see has to determine who is a possible caregiver, who fits closest to this list of qualifications, right? So a senior person has to determine that. A younger person cannot see, you know? So a senior person has to determine who is a possible caregiver. And then that is the one level of programs. And then the other level is that after some time it is announced. So such and such Prabhu and his wife, such and such Prabhu and his wife, such and such Prabhu and his wife, they will offer now regular programs in their house. And whoever feels interested to attend is welcome to attend. So they don't select people or something. No, the people select which program they want to attend. Right? You just announce, so these people have a program in their homes. And please come and join them. And we simply encourage people to go and check them out. you go one a few times to this person, a few times to that person, and then you will very easily feel where you feel most at home, where you can best connect to the leaders there, to the counselors. And then you usually should be settling for one group. You can also sometimes visit another group or something, but it is in one sense a little similar, like with Diksha Shiksha Guru. You know, so first when we accept the Diksha Guru, it's enough work to establish that relationship deeply. So let's just focus on one relationship and cultivate there the mood of surrender and service and, you know. And then only a little later, all right, we can also have Shiksha personalities or something. But we don't like to, you know, recommend this too early, because then again, in the name of taking Shiksha, we can just avoid the discipline, you know? If the instruction gets a little uncomfortable there of the Diksha Guru, oh, I think I need a Shiksha Guru now, you know? And it is actually just because we don't like to be disciplined. So a similar principle we find also on the level of the counselor, you know, so that we do recommend to mainly first, you know, develop one relationship, because especially in this age of impersonalism, it's enough work to really develop a trusting and more personal, confidential relationship with one counselor. But it doesn't mean it's exclusive only with one counselor. You know, of course, there can be also other personalities, but you know, one person should be our main person where we are accountable to and, you know. And I mean, in those yatras where this is practiced, even usually the recommendation for initiation mainly comes from the counselor, because he knows that person the most. You know, so temple president or something is also there, but mainly the counselor. Yes. Yes. And I think, if I'm not wrong, in Chaupati they even have the system that if any counselor disagrees and does not give, you know, the okay for the initiation, then the person does not get initiation. You know? Yes. Yes. So, and best of course is if there's a lot of cooperation amongst the counselors, really, as I said, they really should have this common mood and goal to do something for the devotees in the yatra, really to care and nourish them, you know? And I mean, maybe we can continue there, understanding that, yes, this build to care, this giving and accepting shelter, is really the foundation to all other aspects of care. You know? Like Chaupati, very good example. I hope I don't sound like I'm promoting or something. No. But it is the example, you know, where we can learn from. You know? So like, the way they started is really only with this giving and accepting shelter. So and then, after some years, if everybody is nourished and sheltered and cared for spiritually, then people want to give something. You know, they want to actually also contribute to give some kind of care. And not every devotee is a spiritual caregiver. So some people might think, okay, I want to do something for our devotees by helping them to get married, finding partners. Okay. Let's establish a marriage committee. So then some other people feel, I want to help devotees with finding jobs, you know? So they have some, you know, looking for job offering vacancies, you know, within the devotee community, you know? They have a committee like that. Then other devotees say, oh, I want to help devotees who have difficulties with housing, you know, where to live, you know, and they also are searching for a flat, I'm offering a flat, this, that, I want to live together with somebody, I have his free room. So then there's some committee which deals with these things. You know, so gradually all kinds of committees develop there as the need arises. You know, Yes, as the need was arising, then committee for youth, for children care, for the elderly, for the sick, this, that. But foundation is shelter, spiritual care. Right? I mean, Chaupadi, you might know, they even have their own bank. You know that? Yes, they have their own bank. Yes. Huh?
I did not know that.
You didn't know that? Yes.
They have their own currency.
No. Own bank. Yes. Yeah, because Mumbai, there's a lot of wealthy people there, you know. So, how do they call it again? What's the name of the bank? Huh? Can't remember.
First Lakshmi.
No, something else. Anyway, it doesn't matter what's the name. But they have their own bank, you know, where people take loans. You know, it usually starts with a classic thing that devotees ask a more wealthy person for a loan. You know? So, and they developed it, you know? And they have their own bank, you know, where people keep their money, where people can take loans, and they have, of course, yellow pages, we have that in Mayapur too, but Mumbai, of course, you know, there's so many more businesses and doctors and this and that in the community, you know, there's a lot of professional people, you know, and so many things. So why going outside and getting things done by karmis? Why not staying within the community, you know, and giving each other business opportunities and, you know? So, I mean, it's all pretty amazingly developed. But it all started with this giving and accepting children. That has to be the foundation. Because let us hope that we come to ISKCON to find spiritual shelter and not just, oh, I need, you know, some flat or this or that, you know. No, the spiritual shelter is the main thing. And as I mentioned already, why should we even care for somebody if the person doesn't want to accept guidance? If the person is not serious in accepting the process of devotional life? Why should we bother? You know, we don't want to become a mundane, you know, welfare organization who just cares for the old and the sick and the this and the that. No, the basis has to be giving and accepting shelter. It has to be accepting guidance. Has to be, otherwise the whole thing becomes, the whole idea of devotee care becomes rather sentimental and emotional. You know, it doesn't have that foundation of spiritual care. So good to understand, you know. And I mean, some yatras try and start it from a different angle by first establishing all the committees. Like even here in Mayapur, they started a little like that. And again, I mean, I'm not criticizing Mayapur or something. I'm just observing. And actually, when they started with these committees, I once invited some of the leaders to my place, and I gave them a whole presentation. I said, it started with the giving and accepting shelter, you know? Well, people, yeah, you know, as usual, everybody, yeah, interesting, sounds really good, but then nobody takes it further, you know? This is the whole thing. And I was also explaining this whole thing, bridging on the top level, the different nationalities, you know? And so on, it would be the perfect system to bridge, to build the bridges. You know? But it needs some really dedicated personalities who really hit it out. Otherwise it doesn't happen. Even in Chaupadi, it took many years. You know? Yes. At some stage it was lost again and given up, and then they started it again. Because it's not a cheap thing. You know? Something solid and deep, you have to pay the price, you have to invest. And I've seen it in Ukraine. My God, you wouldn't believe how Narendra Swami's given his blood, sweat and tears for this. I mean, really, really. No. my God, he's putting so much emphasis in it, so much, for about 20 years now, 20 years. He has been tirelessly preaching this, tirelessly, yes. And it takes time, but now really it bears fruit. Just as an example, Kiev Yatra, they have arranged about 80, 90 marriages within the last 6, 7 years. And the basis is council system. If people don't have a counselor, if they don't have this trusting, confidential, intimate friendship with a senior person, they're just not gonna trust anybody in helping them to see who is the right partner for them. That's the point. You know? Your ability to help devotees getting married, it's very much dependent on how much you have a trusting relationship with this person. But if you don't, you actually can hardly even help a person. And I tell you frankly, they have found so many partners for people where I thought, my God, this person will never find anybody, you know? But they have found somebody. Yes, yes. And the marriages work, you know. They don't have a high divorce rate there in the Kiev Yatra, really, you know. Yes, yes, yes. And I mean, that's so urgently needed. I know so many devotees who really, you know, want to get married and they don't know how to find a partner, you know. Yes. It's a big thing, you know. It's a big problem. And if people just, I mean, it's a different issue now. We talk about that in marriage and spiritual culture, how to enter married life. And but, you know, if we just look for ourselves, it first of all contaminates the whole atmosphere. You know, I call it hunting and fishing, you know. People go hunting and fishing for a partner, contaminates the whole atmosphere, you know. And yeah, you go according to your mind and senses, and you know, and very often it doesn't work out, you know. Yeah, so it's a whole issue. So even this can only, we can only serve the devotees in a more substantial way if we have these trusting relationships. Otherwise, people are afraid, they rather want to do it all themselves. And you know, yes, they just don't have that trust. You know. Yes. Also, I mean, here on your handout for today, you know, we have further aspects of devotee care. You know, there's physical care, health and diet, enough rest and exercise, regular medical checkups, this and that. You know, then emotional care is actually, emotional care means care for the mind. You know, emotions are like this, I don't like this, today I hate that person, tomorrow I love that person. So this is the emotional platform, that's the platform of the mind. So of course, this is all, you know, it is all included also in spiritual care. It overlaps. You know, sometimes when people hear spiritual care, they just think, oh, the advice will just be, you better chant Hare Krishna or something. You know? No, I mean, emotional care is already there in just being a good listener, hearing a person, encouraging, being a little empathic, you know, and supportive what the person goes through. You know, giving him the understanding that yes, I know what you feel, you know, and what you're going through, and so this is all emotional care, but it is, actually you can hardly even separate the two, you know, because it really goes hand in hand. And I mean, Krishna consciousness really targets the mind anyway. It always about influencing the mind, actually, you know, subtle body, mind, intelligence, thoughts, ego. You know, so it's hard to so clearly separate, you know, but nevertheless, you know, A compassionate devotee, I wrote here, will always do anything to help alleviate others' suffering. You know? We're not just, just go for Mangalari and that's the solution. No, if a person has some suffering, goes through some things, the compassion, shows in all different fields that we want to help the person in whatever way we can. But, as we said, why should we if the person is not willing to take shelter? That's the point. Yes.
I heard one story of one devotee who had a very difficult childhood. And so when they first came to the temple, they said, my parents beat me and I was not taken care of properly. And they would complain, about their childhood because it was disturbing for them. And one devotee would say, that's just your mind just thinking we're going to generate Krishna. And another devotee would say, but just focus on your sadhana. And they would just dismiss it. But His Grace Jayananda Prabhu, this is an older devotee, when he told Jayananda Prabhu said, that must have been very difficult for you. And just that one sentence made that devotee feel cared for them. And so he stayed in Krishna consciousness all these years. Just for that one little empathy.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes, it is quite amazing how, we might find it so difficult to give that, And we're just so caught up just on the, And we can't even be personal and human or something,
Sometimes we think we get it all complicated in our heads. Like, we're going to have to sit and listen to this person's problem for hours, and we're going to get all caught up, and we won't be able to chant ourselves. But for this person, all it took was one sentence, 5 seconds, just really caring about another person.
Yes.
That's all. Sometimes it doesn't take that much.
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. And I mean, also, we can say, in the same way how we are sometimes, our gross body is sick, diseased, so some diseases just, will be cured just by time going by, and accepting a bit of rest and diet and this and that, but then some diseases are so bad that we have to go and see a doctor, So same thing is there really also on the subtle level. Subtle body. So some disturbances, traumas and they will be resolved just by time going by practicing sincerely, because as we said, the process of Krishna consciousness is targeting the subtle body so much. But then again, some disturbances we might just need a doctor for the subtle body, So that's another thing. We should not feel, a devotee cannot do this. Oh, well, we also go to the doctor for the gross body, so why not for the subtle body, But of course, preferably to a devotee doctor, because non-devotee doctors for the subtle body, they don't know about the mind, intelligence, false ego, this, that. They might just give them wrong advice. They might just say, maybe you just need a bit more sex life here in your life, and then you will feel better or something. So, but I think we have to be a little open to this, If people have more serious traumatic experiences there, then no harm. If we can't solve it, then additionally, there can also be some professional help there. Yes, there is a few other little things which I do want to briefly touch upon. This importance of faith, right? Bhaktivinoda Thakur so nicely, he compares the awakening of faith to the birth of a newborn baby girl, So in other words, if a person comes to Krishna consciousness, his or her faith is very fragile, very delicate, like a newborn baby girl. Girls are usually a little more weaker yogic that boy is, you know. So, and a newborn baby girl needs all protection, all care to grow. So, and this is the same thing when a devotee comes to Krishna consciousness. Faith is very weak still, and this is actually the essence of devotee care, to protect and nourish a devotee's faith. Because if faith is strong, a devotee can survive any trials and tribulations, any calamity. If the faith is strong, then we can see everything somehow in connection with Krishna. We can understand, yes, Krishna is trying to teach me something. There must be some reason why Krishna is putting me in this situation. And the Vaishnava mood is, actually I deserve so much more than that, but Krishna is so kind, he only gives me one drop of what I really deserve. You know? So, but this vision we cannot have if we don't have firm faith in Krishna. Then we cannot even see Krishna in the picture. You know? So that's why this strong, unflinching faith is absolutely necessary, also in order to develop the quality of tolerance. This is also an important topic which we discuss in the men and women in spiritual culture. There it comes up. That tolerance is such an important quality. It's the criteria to measure a person's spiritual strength and advancement. It's tolerance. Yes. This is very opposite to mundane view of things, you know, in the material world and its culture, material life, tolerance is considered to be weakness. What? You tolerate that? I wouldn't tolerate that. You know, just walk out, get divorced, you know, and. You know? Nobody wants to be tolerant. Success is measured in how much you can defend and fight, you know, not in how much you can tolerate. Huh? Yes. But spiritual life, very different. Their tolerance is the criteria for spiritual advancement. Famous example is always Palladma, Charidas Thakura, you know, being able to tolerate so much. Why? Because they're firmly established in their relationship with Krishna. That's the point. They have that unflinching faith in Krishna. That's why they can tolerate. You know? So, if a person's faith in Krishna is nourished, then that person can tolerate any difficulty. But if that faith is not nourished, doesn't matter what we do for the person, run around, do this, that emotional care and that thing and prasadam, you know, when he's sick and this and that. But if we have failed to nourish a person's faith, still at the slightest calamity, he will walk out. He will leave Krishna consciousness. Right? Yes. So that's why the essence of training devotees, of caring for devotees, of devotee care in general, is that point, nourishing and protecting a person's faith. And that's why Bhaktivinoda Thakur also says, you know, the faith in Krishna is the currency by which we can purchase Krishna. Yes, also very nice way to put things, you know? And it's natural, even within human relationships, if you have faith in a person, you know? I mean, that's a sign for a deeper relationship, you know? That conquers the heart. The person has faith in you and sticks with you through thick and thin, you know? But if a person immediately gives up on you and this and that, oh well, then obviously relationship not very deep and meaningful, yeah. So even in our human relationships, it's like that. What to speak of Krishna? So that's what Krishna is also testing us in. How much faith do we have? How much are we willing to tolerate how much, you know, inconvenience are we willing to accept in service to him, you know? Yes, and that's conquering. Krishna feels an effort. Sad is conquered by this today. You know? So, and that is only possible if we have faith. You know? Yes, so in other words, very important to know as a counselor or caregiver that, or any senior devotee or any devotee, we should never act in a way which destroys a person's faith in Krishna, in Prabhupada, in Guru, in the process of devotional service. Yes. Yes, that's a big no-no. You know? Really. Really. And very easily, we've discussed how envy manifests. Very easily, out of envy, we do this. You know, just to undermine somebody else's importance or authority and to establish our supremacy, we say something bad about a person who, you know, a young devotee maybe has faith in. This is very detrimental, you know. And a practical example, you know, if some young bhakta says, oh, such and such Prabhu, he's really inspiring me, he's really great. You know, so, but we might know that actually this person, you know, he's got his problems in his spiritual life, he's not that fantastic or something, but the, you know, the young devotee might not be able to see that, you know. So, no need to tell him, no need to say, oh, yeah, all right, he's okay, but actually, you know, maybe better look at him here, he's much better, you know. No need. As long as a person inspires somebody to practice Krishna consciousness, to chant Hare Krishna, to follow the four regulative principles, he is playing his role there. You know? Even if we think this person is not so super advanced, you know? No need for us to tell the person. No, simply encourage. Yes, yes, he is nice. I'm happy you inspired. Good. You know? And then gradually, as we uplift more and more, he will eventually come to the point where he can discriminate. You know, and I'm sure we all remember this from our beginnings in spiritual life. You know, often we are all starry-eyed and we think, oh, this person is such a sadhu, you know. And then after a while we realize, maybe not so much after all. And we move on to another person. You know? And then he becomes our example and inspiration, and we think he's really far. And then gradually, we make some advancement. And then Krishna sends another person along who will take us further. You know? So no need to make negative comments about somebody, especially if that person has faith in that person, you know? That younger devotee. That destroys faith, you know? And of course, especially detrimental it is when we talk something bad about somebody's guru or something. This is really, oh my God, this is like a killer, you know? Yes, yes, yes. Even if we might know something or whatever, you know? No. Never, you know, damage a person's faith. Very important. You had your hand up. You wanted to say something. That's all. Yes?
About this shortening the relationship, is it a important criteria that the shelter giver should be always around, like to observe the past meaning of spiritual life? Or if this relationship can be developed somehow when they're
in distance? Remote control. Well, you know, let's put it that way. For example, I often have people asking me, oh, can you be my counselor? So I always say, I can be some kind of a person there in your life, but you better also look for somebody locally. Because it can be very convenient to say, oh yeah, Devaki Mataji is my counselor, but she's never there, she doesn't know what's going on. You know? So sometimes people like to take somebody who is away, so you know, so they avoid the discipline there, you know. Apart from the fact that somebody away cannot have the regular programs and all this, you know. So usually we recommend, you know, a local person who can really more assess how are you practicing and how are you cooperating with other devotees. Are you putting yourself into the fire of service? Like this morning in the Bhagavatam class, you know, it was about the topic of intensity in devotional life. But just to, you know, check Facebook and cruise around and have a bit of prasadam and have a nap, and, you know, and then fingering the beads a little bit. Well, we're just not going to get that much purification from such kind of situation, you know. But if the intensity in service, like Diti had for a whole year there, you know, or Dhruva Maharaj, he was going through the whole example of Dhruva Maharaj. So that gives the purification, the fire of devotional life. So, you know, a local person can really see this more. Are we actually really endeavoring to our utmost capacity here in service? And you know, but then another person can be there also, you know, who is inspiring, who gives maybe something which the local person cannot really give. You know, as we said, it's hard to find inspiration and shelter on all levels in one person. You know? So, and we have to be practical, we somehow have to start somewhere, you know, so we can take additional shelter and inspiration from people on other levels. There can be a local person, then there can be somebody in the same country, which we maybe see 3-4 times a year. So then there can be somebody else on another level, which we maybe see once a year at a festival or something, you know. Yes. So there can be different levels. But I highly recommend, if possible, there should be somebody in the local yatra, if possible. Yes. Okay, anything else about faith? I'd like to share one little thing which is connected to this topic, you know. Actually, yes, I can just share. I once asked Narendra Swami what to do if we notice some, you know, little anatta, some discrepancy, some, you know, some problem in a very senior devotee. What to do? It was causing me some problems, you know. Sometimes I'm a little perceptive, I can feel things, and I was really having some guilt feelings there that I see these things and I shouldn't be seeing this, and oh, I'm like the fly, only seeing the school stool here, and so I simply went to Narendra Swami, I asked him how to deal with this, and he gave me a very good answer which just helped me so much, and that's why I want to share it with you, hoping that it will also help you. You've got it here on your sheet. He gave me three principles. Principle number one, don't suppress it, meaning, you know, don't get all absorbed in guilt feelings that you see something which you shouldn't be seeing. No, accept the fact that we are all in the wash, you know. We all have something which we still have to work on, even on the level of bhava. There can still be some anattas there, something can still be there, you know. So naturally also as we are maturing more, we become naturally more perceptive to subtleties, you know. While we are young devotee and we are still so covered in ignorance there, we don't even perceive But naturally, the more purified we are, the more perceptive we are to subtle energies and things, you know? Yes, yes. So, don't suppress it. Understand, yes, it's a fact. We can't expect every senior devotee to be, you know, 100% pure devotee or something. We are, like the famous example of the hospital, you know? This gun is like a big hospital. So we are in the hospital because we're sick, we want to get healthy. So we can't just point the finger, oh, he is sick and he's vomiting and he's passing stool there on the floor and this and that. Well, we all have our symptoms here of the disease and we have to tolerate each other and encourage each other to become healthy. You know, but it doesn't mean it's a bad hospital, just the fact that there are sick people there or something. You know?
They need to be orderly somewhere.
Huh?
They need to be some orderly somewhere to clean up.
Yes,
and
so...
Doctors get sick sometimes also.
Huh?
And doctors get sick sometimes.
Yes, doctors also get sick sometimes too. Yes, yes. So, don't suppress it. Point number one. Second one, don't dwell on it. Yes, yeah, everybody understands what it means to dwell on something. It means, oh, it goes around and around in your mind, you can't stop thinking about it, you can't just put it aside, you're like, you're dwelling, oh, but yeah, he's got a real problem, and so it means actually we have a problem. What does it mean? What's our problem? Envy, yes, good old friend, envy. Well, it basically, what is underneath it is that we think, well, actually, he should not get that recognition and that position and all that because I can see he's got a problem, you know? So there's this subtle envy there and that's why we're dwelling, you know? Yes. So don't suppress, don't dwell on it, don't broadcast it. That's also a good one, you know? Don't think you have to tell everybody about it and save others from that person's association or something. You know? No need, no need. All this talking about other people's problems, it just magnifies negativity. That's all it does. It doesn't help anybody. It also took me a while to really understand this. You know? Yes. Yes. So, but all this talk about other people's problems and negativity, it just increases it, it blows it up, it makes it go around, you know, so many times around the globe here, the sound vibration, you know. So, no need, it doesn't help anybody, it doesn't help the person involved, it doesn't help you, it doesn't help the people who you tell about it, you know, it actually contaminates everybody, you know. So, no need, no use. No use. This broadcasting, no use. So I found this very helpful, you know? Don't suppress it, don't dwell on it, don't broadcast it. Just put it aside, just understand, yes, we're all in the wash, you know? And obviously that person also has something to work on, we all do, you know? Yes. I thought it was very helpful. Okay. I mean, in that regard, if you like, I could quickly read this one purport where we have the number on there, 4412. I have this in my verse book here. This is the chapter where Sati speaks to Daksha. Right? Where this whole thing is with Daksha and Shiva and Sati that burns herself up there, you know? So she instructs Daksha. She says a pretty good thing here. She says, there are some highly qualified persons who accept only the good qualities in us. Just as a bee is always interested in the honey in the flower and does not consider the thorns and colors, highly qualified persons who are uncommon, accept only the good qualities of others, not considering their bad qualities. Whereas the common man can judge what are good qualities and what are bad qualities. In other words, what she's saying is, just to judge what is good and what is bad, that's common person. That's common stuff. Anybody can do that, right? To see what is good and what is bad. We often think, oh, that's such a big qualification here, or I can see this is bad. Oh, well, that's common. That's common thing. But the highly qualified person, he accepts the good thing. It doesn't mean he doesn't see the bad thing. It doesn't mean that. It also took me a long time to understand. I always was thinking, oh, sadhu should not see the bad things. No, he's not stupid. Of course he sees. But he simply doesn't take them as so important. He just accepts the good thing. This one regarding the thorns of the flower, Doesn't mean he doesn't see them. Of course he sees them. But he doesn't accept them. Among the uncommon among the uncommonly good souls, interesting English, among the uncommonly good souls, there are still gradations, and the best good soul is one who accepts an insignificant asset of a person and magnifies that good quality. Very nicely put. So, alright, it's a common stuff to see what is good and what is bad. So, and it is uncommon souls, they accept just the good thing. So, but then amongst those uncommon souls, even there is gradation. And the best of these uncommon souls, they accept a tiny little good thing and they magnify it. They blow it up. And that's actually, in one sense we can say, that's really what a counselor should be able to do. Actually. Well, at least we should be striving for this. Well, I mean, yes, the common person sees what good is good and bad. So now a devotee should be able to accept only the good. And amongst the devotees, a counselor is a pretty... one of the best people amongst the uncommon people. That's the counselor. We can explain it like that, But that is really the art of encouraging people. And I mean, Prabhupada was just the perfect example, Prabhupada could just see a tiny little spark of inclination to serve. And he could just magnify that, he could just fan it, until that spark becomes a fire, and then the fire burns up all the, anattas anyway, if we can just give that encouragement to the, to the sparks there, and fan them. Of course, which doesn't mean that we don't have to sometimes also correct or instruct or something. But just, Prabhupada was really just so expert at this. Really, one of my favorite stories is from Korma Prabhu's book, The Transcendental Adventure. There is this story of this, what was it, Shamasundra, I think, was his name. I don't know which Shamasundra, or Shamananda, don't know. Shamananda maybe. He was an artist, a painter, And he had gone off a little off track. He had gone a little in Maya. You know, he had long hair and a beard and was not coming to the temple anymore. So then Prabhupada was coming to Melbourne. And that Charmananda wanted to give Prabhupada a nice painting. It's still hanging in the Melbourne room. Yes, yes, it's still hanging there. And there's Krishna, I think, playing on the flute, and there's some rainbow thing there behind. Krishna Radharani. Very nice painting. So, and then Charmananda came with this painting to the temple, wanting to meet Prabhupada. So all the devotees were very curious. How will Prabhupada deal with him? With his long hair and his beard and, you know, being a little covered over and, you know, probably not changing or whatever. So, and all the devotees were all anxious to watch the scenario, you know. And I mean, for those who've been to Melbourne Temple, you know, in Prabhupada's house there, you know, the stairs are going up pretty steep to Prabhupada's rooms. So Charmananda was carrying this big painting there up, you know, meeting Prabhupada. And all the devotees were all anxious. They were all hiding in all the rooms, peeking out the doors there, you know. In Melbourne there's so many rooms. So they all wanted to witness what is going to happen. How is Prabhupada going to react to this when he sees Charmananda? And they all thought he would just get on his case and chastise him and. So and then Prabhupada happily welcomed Charmananda, you know, and he just kind of, he ruffled affectionately the hair. Oh, what is this? And he was, you know, he was, you know, doing a little beard there, you know, tickling a little bit. Oh, what's this beard? What's the hair? You know? And then Charmananda was saying, I don't know. Why I have them, you know? Now, first he was saying, I wear them so I can preach to people and look like them, you know? And then he said, actually, Prabhupada, I don't know why I have them, you know? And both were laughing, you know? So Prabhupada was in a very charming way. He was giving attention to the fact that he had the long hair and the beard. But he did it in such an affectionate and charming way, which immediately released all tension or anything, or discomfort, you know. But then Prabhupada gave so much attention to this painting, you know. He was looking at it for several minutes and was saying, oh, this is so beautiful, and this is what I want to see every morning when I get up, when I wake up, this is what I want to see. First thing, and when I take rest, this is what I want to see again, you know. And he was really lovingly gazing at this picture, at this painting. And then he said a very sweet thing to Charmananda. He said, I can write, you cannot write. You can paint, I cannot paint. So let us work together. Yes. And Charmananda just, he was so encouraged. You know, he was just floating out of Prabhupada's room there, you know, being so happy. Oh, Prabhupada accepted my gift. You know, he liked it so much. He wants to hang it on the walls there. So he sees it every evening, every morning when he wakes up. You know, and yeah, he was just so immensely encouraged, you know. And all the other devotees, they were in shock. You know, wow, he really got Prabhupada's mercy. He got so much affectionate care there, you know. They were completely blown away because they expected something different. They thought Prabhupada would just hammer him and smash him and, you know, get on his case, you know. But yeah, Prabhupada in a very charming way, he just handled the situation so wonderfully, you know, and really encouraged that devotee. You know.
When I was younger, as a woman, I used to always think of Prabhupada as this chastiser, this master chastiser. He smashed me. But as I read more and more about the letters and things, Prabhupada almost actually never did that. It was like maybe a 3 to 5%. you're saying taking the little thing and magnifying it. So right. Why is it that as young devotees, immature devotees, we get this image of Prabhupada that he's like the master smasher?
Well, because I mean, he did have that side to him too, you know. I mean, he had the thunderbolt there, you know.
But it was relatively rare.
Huh?
It was relatively rare to his other actions.
I'm not sure, you know, that I've read quite a lot of books about Prabhupada's pastimes, but how exactly the balance and mixture was, I don't really know. But as far as I understand, he just had the perfect mix, you know, of the thunderbolt and the soft as a rose. And even when he was getting his thunderbolt out, it was all in that affectionate, caring spirit, you know. And that's why people actually accepted it, you know. And that's why it transformed their hearts. And I mean, there is also sometimes you can read how Prabhupada afterwards was saying, you know, almost apologizing and saying, well, please don't mind me speaking like this, but it is simply out of affection, you know, and it's my duty to train and correct here and that, you know. But point is, in order to be like that, one has to be non-envious. That's the point. You know, if one is non-envious, then one can get out a little thunderbolt every now and again. You know, but as long as we have so much envy still, we can't imitate, because then, you know, our thunderbolt will be contaminated with envy and it will not be purified, you know. Yes, that's the difference, you know. So Prabhupada could speak so strong because he was non-envious. He had no other interest except, you know, everyone's upliftment, you know. Yes. Okay, well, I think this is basically all I want to share with you. So now one question, have you filled in the feedback forms? Emailed. Yes, but my experience is often people don't do it. I mean, you were very nicely doing it for the whole time or two, but often people, unless they do it, even next week, unless you come to the course next week, I might not even see you or something, you know. But just to, yeah, so please feedback form, if possible, please fill it in, you know, or give it to me in the morning program or whatever. And also just a little bit more preview there for those who don't know, we do have more seminars, more courses. Next week will be the Vanaprastha Ashram.
Same time,
same place, 3 to 6 o'clock, Monday to Friday. And just for everybody's clarity, Vanaprastha Ashram doesn't mean, oh, this is only interesting for me if I'm 50 or something. I dare say, you know, any devotee should have a clear understanding. What is this Vanaprastha Ashram all about? It should be general education, you know? Yes. And sooner or later we will also, unless we leave, you know, prematurely, we will also reach this stage and we have to encourage other people maybe around us or something. I mean, it should be common knowledge in ISKCON, what is this Vanaprastha all about, you know? What's the internal mood and cultivation? And I will also put a couple of sessions on, you know, on death actually, you know? Yeah, I do have a separate seminar on death and I put a few things in there because it's just such an important thing to understand deeply what is actually happening at the moment of death. And my experience is once we discuss that, people do take Krishna consciousness more seriously because they realize I have only a certain amount of time left here and I better prepare. And I have so much influence, you know, it really depends on me, how I am prepared. Of course, it also depends on Krishna's mercy, but Krishna reciprocates to our endeavors on preparing. You know, it does shake us up, No? Yes, yes. It's a little bit of an earthquake there to actually realize, you know, because this topic of death, we are so expert to sweep this under the carpet and pretend this is not going to happen to us and all this, you know. Yes. And that's why we think, oh, we've got all the time of the world here and we can just cruise along and you know, and space out and play around and, you know, but once we realize, wow, death is coming, well, we better get our act together, you know. Yes. Yeah, so and then after that week of Vanaprastha, there will this course men and women in spiritual culture, which is also
together this time?
Yes. Yes. This time.
Provided a pathway that I can see actually. Sometimes, you know, certain instructions, they feel really good, flowery words, and warm and fuzzy in the heart, but it's still kind of like, well, how do I really get there?
Yes.
This course didn't leave me.
Yes. Oh, well, that's good.
So thank you.
Good. Also, really, community development, this giving and accepting shelter is the key. Actually, the deities and giving and accepting shelter. Deities being in the center and giving and accepting shelter. then a community develops. If we have these two things there. Only the deities is not enough. You know? Not enough. Devotees have to be shelters. You know? Yes. If we have these two things in our communities, then they become Vaikuntha eventually, you know? Anybody else wants to share something?
I was just thinking like the principles that you described. It's like, I mean, it really is a preparation for the spiritual world. Is that when we're reading Krishna book or Chaitanya Charitamrita, like, you know, like, there's Krishna, there's Mahaprabhu, but there's also all these wonderful loving relationships between everybody, mentioning that quite a lot throughout the course. How in Gloka Vrindavan there's, you know, like the elderly gopis are, you know, kind of encouraging the younger ones in their service to Krishna. You know, like there's all these, you know, communities, you know, with loving relationships. So, yeah, it's like a practice, you know, cultivating that humility so that we can,
I mean, that's also a good point, you know, sometimes we hear people say, oh, I don't fit into, you know, big communities and this and that, too many people. Oh, well, you know, Goloka Vrindavan, there's a huge community of unlimited numbers of living entities, that they all work in complete harmony, you know, to make the most pleasing arrangement there for Krishna's pleasure. So if we want to go there, well, we better get used to be part of a big we better learn to fit in, you know, otherwise we were not allowed to enter there, you know, very clear. Anybody else wants to share something? Yes?
I'm very grateful to you. Какие-то мои поступки были служения, я думала, что они были неправильные, но я на этом курсе поняла, что я правильно поступала. И я за это вам очень благодарна. И тема, I'm very grateful for you that you nourished my faith, and I was thinking that I was doing some mistakes in my service, but now I understand, I realize that I did everything right.
Okay.
И тема, которую вы затронули за этикет, она никак не продвигается нигде. То есть ее не изучают и не доносят до молодежи, которая приходит только пробегается.
The topic of etiquette you discussed, it's really true. I also see that it's not touched upon thoroughly, especially among young devotees, like who are being just newcomers, they're not trained properly. This is a big field where you can share your knowledge and you can try to help other people to know this and let them know this etiquette more.
Okay.
Thank you so much for sharing.
Anybody else wants to say something? Yes.
Mataji, also have a question.
Okay.
Probably, I don't know if it's been covered, but generally when you take shelter, some people can they take shelter from the holy name? Some people say take shelter from the holy name. And also some people, they generally talk with their AD, just like, maybe one way, but they keep telling all of their problems or asking for all solutions and things. Sometimes they get some things from outside. How does that sheltering compare to the sheltering with the normal problems?
Well, we did mention, you know, that this topic of taking shelter is there. It accompanies us throughout our whole spiritual life on all levels. Taking shelter of Krishna, taking shelter of the holy name, taking shelter of Prabhupada, of Guru. But unless we cultivate taking shelter of the devotees, not so easy to take shelter of the other aspects, you know? And of course, taking shelter of the holy name is also there, but still, again and again, the holy name is not going to come and tap us on the shoulder and say, hey, your spiritual practice is imbalanced. You know, we do need sadhu. We do need an alive person, that intimate friend. You know? And in regards to talking to the deities, easily we can become a little sahajiya too, you know. Just, oh, I talked to my deity and my deity told me, and God knows, you know. But devotee, a counselor, he will let us know, you know, where we're going wrong and what the problem is. And he can help us assess ourselves. You know, holy name, deity, not sure if they can help us assess ourselves. We can imagine so many things, you know, in our conditioned stage. You know, we cannot even discriminate what is the deity and what is just my mind, you know. What's my mind telling me and what is Paramatma or the deity telling me? I mean, to really have, you know, an exchange there with the deity, you have to be pretty advanced, you know. Yes. I mean, the deity doesn't talk so easily to us neophytes, you know. You know? Yes. I mean, we have to be very careful, you know.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was also very, when I came to the class, I was never feeling the need for the shelters. I really got amazed that it's essential for me.
Where are you serving?
I'm serving right now here, locally in Mayapur.
Okay. But you where from originally?
Andhra Pradesh, south of India.
Okay. So, Bhagi Mataji. We need Yes. Very true. That's what we were defining sheltering relationship is, that we want to be corrected and disciplined. You know? So, but holy name, deity, how will they correct and discipline us, you know? Sorry? Devotees who want to be corrected are very few. Well, it just shows that it's not so easy to truly take shelter, you know? We have all our boundaries there and protective walls around us, and we defend and this and that, you know. Prabhupada's presence simply inspired, you know, the surrender, you know. Yes, and I mean, Prabhupada is still there, that's the point, you know. It's not that he's gone, he's there in his books, and he is present in devotee's lives. Anyway, I also want to thank you for being such a nice audience and taking part so nicely and asking so many good questions and being with it. So it was a great pleasure to spend my time with you. And I hope I will meet some of you in the other courses. Thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada.